I became a farmer because my father was a farmer, but he had been a coal miner before that, and I always wanted to be a farmer, basically.
Well, I became a farmer as I inherited a family, third generation farm, a local dairy farm, and always wanted to be. I broke my leg playing fit when father told me I should make up my mind whether I'm being a farmer or playing football, so that decided my decision was to become a farmer.
Well, I would say that becoming a farmer came a lot later to me because I was a shepherd, my father was a shepherd before that, my mother's side, the whole lot, my father-in-law. My mother was not, my mother was mother-in-law was English, her father was a miner down in Lancashire. Circumstances and such like came round to my son and I taking over the rent of a farm in 2000. So it was not a case of inheriting a farm or taking over. It was no sort of, what's the word I'm looking for? Progression. Or,
yes.
But the second part of this question is easy to become a farmer if you're not born into a farming family. Well, I know one or two that have been very successful in farming in their own right, and they came from a town background, you might say. But I would say farming generally now is to try to get into farming is just about, it's nearly an impossibility.
Nearly impossibility.
The bits of money that's involved, that's the big
thing. Well, the first thing you've got to do is get a bit of ground.
Aye.
And with this right to buy and all these the government,
things.
You know, there's.
Yeah, doesn't, no, they don't.
Because really, you know, we're not farming, and we're the tenant farmers, but we were fortunate our landlord gave us the opportunity to start, because there's been very few opportunities in the last 20 odd years.
That's it, it's very few.
And if you got the opportunity, how do you stock it?
Yeah, well, my father, he was down the pits until the war came along.
Right.
He came up to New Battle Abbey, he was an Army Medical Corps, and that's where they were nursing wounded.
Mm-hmm.
And because my grandfather had a farm, and it was rented, he always wanted to get in farming, but he didn't know how, and he just really, after the war, he kind of fell into it. But it was much easier then. Tenants were wanted.
It sounds easy in hindsight. Maybe it wasn't as easy at the time.
No,
wouldn't be easy at the time, but trying to find them. Lent money and what was
going on. Well, I mean, he started off by running a melt round at Newton Grange.
Mm-hmm.
There were a melt round went with the farm anyway, my father took it. That's how he progressed in the farm.
But again, I don't think any of the three of us, if you get the life, you'd always do things differently.
Oh.
But you would probably just do the same job again.
Well, that's it.
Would you not?
None of us would change what we did.
No.
My situation was we started off and rented farms on Kipfield Estate, and the progression that we were able to buy them. At one point, when I reached my generation, it was a 150-acre dairy farm. I still had a mother, a father, and a living, and a father living. A son who was getting married, and I couldn't see where I could make it pay on 150-acre.
No.
So eventually, I did the same. I took a late farm and progressed to there.
Oh, well, we started a very small farm down at Melrose. It was only 18 acre originally. That was after the war.
Mm-hmm.
We had more bits and pieces of land round about the Melrose than there was actually any wee farm.
That's a farm you had yourself.
But that might be the same to some people in this day.
It may well be. I mean,
we can think of some that's probably doing something similar, can't we?
Yes, they're thinking. Well, I know of somebody he has part of his father-in-law's farm, but he has other bits round about.
It's kind of round about.
Aye.
You know, to try and make it pay with acres, he needs to make it pay.
Well, that's it. He's got a job as well, so that's, you know, a lot of people in Ireland have small farms, mm-hmm. but they take a job.
Mm-hmm. You could say the same for the crofters in Ireland.
Oh, no, exactly. I mean, they've
maybe got five jobs.
Well, aye. But that's the way it is. He just has to do what he can do at the time. That's the important thing.
Well, yeah, you know, hindsight's a great thing.
Oh, a great thing, absolutely. Now, this question is, it seems to me that farming is quite loaded with different responsibilities, making a living and succeeding as a business, providing employment, custodianship of the land, in appearance for nature and for leisure, upholding rural ways of life and traditions, food production, etc., etc. What for you are the rewards of being a farmer, and what are the challenges? I've never really thought about that one.
No, because it's a way of life, isn't it?
It's a way of life, that's...
And you're making, well, maybe some folk that are making a living, that depends what you want out of life.
Well, it does, that's the thing.
If you're wanting to be tertiary holidays a year, well, I know some farmers that do, but, not many of us.
No,
because would you want to call it your pension or whatever, it's tied up running about you every day, isn't it?
That's the thing, that's what it is. And, well, if you want the business to go on through your antecedents, it's like robbing Peter to pay Paul. Mm. You're taking money away from them if you're doing that sort of thing. At least that's what.
But it's, I think it is getting, you know, as a business, as I say, that your business is in four legs or in a crop or whatever.
Mm. Well, I know my son thinks of it as a business.
Yes, he has a different, like...
Oh, everything's got to be sound monetarily, otherwise it doesn't get done. That's the way it is.
Well, I can understand that to a certain extent, and it's a modern way of thinking. Maybe, yeah.
Maybe that's where our generations went wrong with thinking we're not entertaining out of farming nowadays. My mind, when I left school, going back a good number of years now, and I came home and worked on the farm, and I got my pocket money. And father said, oh, the farm will be used someday.
Aye, that's right.
Just work away hard and we'll get one fine. But that's when the mistake was made for the income side of our businesses today.
Yeah.
I maintain that it was my generation. We should have come home and said in their days that we were needing a wage out the farm.
Yes.
And we didn't do that.
But do you not think that probably there wasn't a... And I don't know
there
if
might not have been a wage there.
There might not have been a wage in it,
But that's where we should have started and said that's where we're needing. That's what we need to be.
Yeah.
That's where we should be.
Well, you get the knock-on effect for that because food's...
And it's still happening today.
Well, food's still too cheap.
Mm. Ah, it's too cheap, that's the trouble. It's too cheap.
And I know that the outside world probably says that's, you know, again, that's just like farmers. And I don't like to be crying wolf, to be fair, but...
No, neither do I.
For what you put into it, or what's tied up monetary-wise... You know, it's a pretty helter-skelter.
Well, it is, because it's going up and down on the same value.
You just don't know. You know, what we're getting now, probably monetary terms was the same about 10 or 15 years
ago. Well,
The milk price of the back down to what it was.
Well, I mean, I see tonight on the television, there's, you know, a woman saying, oh, it's the milk and the butter prices, but... Actually, they've gone down.
Wow.
You know, to what they were at their peak,
mm-hmm.
They've gone down.
Now.
And that's very, that doesn't happen in a lot of commodities, that they actually go down, they maintain their value.
Water's dearer than milk, is it?
I have just...
But you talk about the custodian of the land and appearance, well...
Well, we're always working on that.
Well, but you don't think that, you know, if... In our area in particular, if you're looking about, it doesn't look too bad in this part of the country.
No.
Now, how does it look like that?
Well, because people
like this, you've been looking after it for years. It's in your interest.
I mean, we make jokes about how people farm. For the most part, we don't like getting up in the morning and seeing a mess.
Mm-hmm.
No.
That's what I feel.
No.
You didn't want to get up and see a dykes falling down and...
But, you know, well, custodian and appearance, that's what you're talking about, the appearance for nature and for leisure. Well, for me, personally speaking, nature has lost all kind. We're covered with vermin, and especially in wing kind.
Mm-hmm.
You know, crows, jackdaws, and they've never had it so good, and seagulls, because we're going about with these snackers and there's...
Well, I mean, that's the thing. The animals that get these things said about them, like hedgehogs and, you know, these sort of things, we can't really do very, in a farming sense, we can't do very much about them because they are small animals that live in the bottom of hedges and whatnot. Mm-hmm. You can put the hedges in right now, but what else can you do? You know?
Well, but how does that, you know, I know in our own instance in the hill there, it's not a shooting, there is just a grouse in it, but they don't
shoot it.
No. They're never going to get a chance because these crows are just harrowing it.
Oh, yes.
You know, there's nothing.
And the chicks will be murdered in the
summer. And nice wee peewits and that, they're all...
We used to always have a field of oats. Mm. And when I left the school, Father used to go around and mark the peewits' nest so I didn't roll out of them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Somebody that does that at home, man.
We never see a peewit now. How do you feel about meat consumption contributing to climate change? Are there any viable options in upland areas to move production from more sustainable and environmentally friendly foods?
Well, I think climate change is our racket.
Well, there may well be climate change, but we don't get the actual any plaudits for the amount of carbon we sequestrate, because they don't count grass as a sequestrator of carbon, and it actually can do more than a woodland. So
do you not think that the problem is there's three of us sitting here just now, and then these scientific guys, I don't think they all agree with each other.
No, they don't.
So we're left somewhere.
We're left in the middle, and it's the worst place to be.
What you're saying there is actually a lot of people have said exactly the same.
Yeah.
You know, you would think there has to be somebody in there or an organisation
saying, with
look, this is actual fact.
Nobody seems to be able to take to put out decent figures.
No.
That they understand at all.
We've got so much big business.
Big business and putting pressure against us.
Who are not worried about how much carbon they chuck up in the air, so long as they have trees to say it's sequestrated.
And the governments are piling money into them, and most of that money isn't even staying in this country.
Well, that's it. It's going somewhere else.
I think it's till, you know, when somebody will realise someday.
Well, I mean, the people say, oh, they'll notice it when they've no food to eat. But the thing is, they won't. They'll try and buy it for somewhere else.
No, because always food. And I don't, you know, Scotland are going to... We're going to plant trees, and we're going to this, and we're going to do that, and look at all the different schemes they've got with this heating type thing and such like. But Mr. What's his name in India and China, what do they say, one new coal plant a week going up in India?
That's it, one new coal China. Plant, huh?
Now, you know, we're actually, it's a detriment to Scotland as a whole.
As a small island, we cannot compete with that, the amount of carbon that's being chucked out, we just can't do it.
Well, I come from the parish of Leshamhead in Lancashire originally.
Uh-huh.
And the one individual who's got a nursing home project, and they're an estate running beside this nursing home, which consisted of about a dozen farms, dairy farms in Lancashire, 120 to 150 acre. He decided he was going to buy this estate up. He proceeded to do so, bought a lot of the farms out, and then got into serious trouble with the banks.
Uh-huh.
And the only person who could bail out this plan was the Forestry Commission.
Aye.
Now, there are a dozen farms, ideal set-up farms for young fellas who want to step up in agriculture, going into trees. Aye. And the whole thing at the present moment's a bloody maze.
Aye. And we don't seem to be getting on anything in a big enough scale to compensate. Coal is not as big as it was. But it is still there, and it's still... We're not chucking up anything like they are, but we can do a lot with wind, especially at sea, because there's a lot of... But we need to move these things along. We can't, as farmers, we can't do that. You know, we can't actually move that along very much at all. We can put up windmills on land, but they don't seem to be... A lot of the places they don't seem to be like.
Well, I usually find it's the incomers that don't like it.
Yeah, I know.
Probably.
It's amazing how many people, you say, don't like windmills. But it's generally people who come in from
they don't want anything but themselves.
No, they just, well, it's like the bull. We had cows doing there, but we didn't have a bull with them. and I was in checking the cows, and this woman comes rushing up the road. You'll have to stop that bull, it's roared all night, and I can't get asleep. I says, well, I'm sorry, but it's not my bull, but cattle were here a long time before you were here, dear. And, oh, she didn't let her at all. Oh, not at all, you know.
No, but that's what you're... What's our next...
Forcing against nowadays.
Oh, it's...
What's our next question? With all the proven environmental benefits, why don't farmers plant more hedges and trees? Is it about funding or tradition or concern about profitability or something else?
No, I mean, we have planted trees. I mean, I know you have planted woodland up there, but we have to have an income from the other part of the farm. We can't get any income from that, so we can only do it on... Each person can only do it, as far as I can see, on a limited...
On a basis,
you know?
And I think also this is my sort of thing. As an owner-occupier, you can do what you want.
Yeah.
But as a tenant...
You can't.
What we've actually done is more a sort of flood prevention thing, I think, type thing. But hedges, I think, what was one of the mistakes we made, we should have put in more hedges. Now, I believe... Government or whoever, in their wisdom, you don't need hedges in this area.
No.
So there's no grant for them.
No. It's a bit.
So we're not going to put something in there. We're not going to be spending money for something.
No.
We're never going to maybe see the benefit.
Well, it's a bit like we're looking at buying slurry storage because we only have enough slurry storage for 50% of the year, the winter anyway, and. We're looking at that at the moment, and this is a livestock area, but because we're not in an NVZ, we only get a very small grant for doing this. But if you're over the hill, you get 50%. Now,
this is the unfairness of a lot of the schemes that's coming out, and probably will come out in the future as well, through the environment. There's going to be different areas.
I don't think there'll be money there for them.
Well.
That's another situation at the moment.
Like I said, what we're trying to do, you know, even with selling the carbon, the figures would never the way the price everything's went up,
if we are going to put hedges and trees in, the amenity trees or hedges, we have to be paid for it. You know, it's land that's tied up in something else other than the thing that makes money for us. You know, we can live by.
We're taking land out of production to do it.
Yes, that's the thing.
The way we would look at it is, it was bits of waste, you know, bits of water, you can't do anything else with. They were a nightmare.
Aye.
But the other thing that is the shelter. That's the big thing.
That's the big thing, right.
And, you know, that's where, but we're at the stage now that
The way government is going at the present moment, they're taking away our money without the moment giving us it.
That's the thing.
Well, that's it. So that would, the funding or tradition.
I mean, it is nice to see well-kept hedges, but, you get the grant to put them in, but then you have to maintain those hedges to keep them, to keep it. As well, not
well,
just
you know where the hedge cutter comes from, don't you?
Oh yes, he's well off.
well, nobody's billing it.
The way he's spending money on machinery, it must be getting to be somewhere.
One of the so-called experts, forestry guys, reckon we shouldn't be keeping it at all.
No,
you should just let it grow. I suppose it's not the main road.
The thing is, every time it grows, a hawthorn hedge might grow out. A foot a year,
right.
So it's no longer, it's got a hell of a big chunk of land.
No, I know, and you've got, and then if you're wanting the grant, you've got to take in so many metres.
Yes.
Anyway, what was your question?
What kind of interactions do you have with other countryside users?
That's a woman with a bull.
Yes. What change, if any, would you like to see in relationships between farmers and other rural residents and countryside users? Well, the one bugbear is the dog walker.
You've had a bad time
with him. Oh, I mean, there was a I was down that tuck field, it had been cut for arable silage, and we ploughed it and we were sowing it out with battalion ryegrass, this for the sheep are on now. And this guy came in at the top end on the other side, and he had two dogs, and these dogs both had to have a shit, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And he never did nothing about it, so I stopped the truck there. Yeah, I said, have you got a poly bag? No, they're at home. I says, well, I don't know what get it home. I says, you can walk, but clean up after your dogs, you know. And that's, it's been a real bugbear.
You've had a bad time on you,
isn't it? Aye, so that's the one thing that
we're fortunate that so far, touch wood, that we've not.
No.
We do have one or two that have houses there, and I always think they're not just overloaded with manners somewhere.
No.
You know, they're walking through the field, they're down the side of the shed. You know, we wouldn't walk through their garden.
No, well,
but they feel like they've got every right to be.
Yeah.
Strangely enough, we have friends who farm. Folk were walking through their fields again, and dogs messing. So one day he just decided that he would watch this, and once the dog had messed, and then she walked away from the dog in the mess, and so he decided he would follow her. So he went into the splinting scheme. He got the number of the house and whatnot. So he went back and he gathered up this mess into a bag, and he took it up and he dumped it on the lawn, and she was gone absolutely spare. And he says, well, that's what you did to me, and it's your dog shit, so...
But how do you actually speak to the people? I don't think you really can.
Well, you can't lose your temper, you know? If you lose your temper, you're lost.
I know a retail milkman who had the same problem with the wife of his dog coming down into his yard and cocking its leg on his milk crate.
Exactly.
So he gathered up his old dog, he called dog day, and I... and gathered the same as bit out and put it into her garden, and said she went mental the same, where it stopped her dog coming down peeing in his milk crates. That seems to be the only way to get the message.
But suppose you had a, you know, it said there, what was it, it said a relation for a country, so, you know, suppose you had a meeting with them once a week in the town hall.
Well, the thing is that not all of them, but some of them think it is a right.
No.
You know, they have a right to roam, yes, but what they don't have is a right to make a mess of your land, you know, and that's the thing that drives us up the wall, you know, on a regular basis.
I knew a previous farm at Thornhill at Dumfries, we had an ancient castle on the premises,
uh-huh,
which was visited every weekend.
Aye.
And that was a nuisance.
Yes.
We had to make sure that everything was A1 every weekend,
before the game.
And what they left, as you said, what they left behind them was unreal.
I mean, if they want to walk across,
don't mind them walking or exercising, as long as you leave things as they go at them.
Yes, that's
somebody says to me, can I exercise my dog, so long as you keep your dog under control, and it doesn't bother me.
No, that's the thing. No.
But you remember, we've got sheep in that field that's worth quite a bit of money.
No, that's the thing, that's what you've got to, well, you have to try and explain to them, but some of them it doesn't get through.
Well, runoff contaminated by, when you were on about
slurry.
By nitrogen fertilisers causes severe damage on fishery stocks. There are many other less toxic forms of fertiliser, and cutting down on chemical fertiliser not only saves on the production side, but also helps on the environmental side. Are you and other farmers aware of the dangers of using nitrogen fertilisers? If so, why do they continue to be used?
Well, it's easy. That's the basic. I mean, we have, since started doing paddock grazing,
mm-hmm,
our nitrogen usage has gone down to a quarter of what it was. And that's purely because of the fact that we've got more clover in the sward. And that's why I started grazing cows and grazing sheep on turnips. Because the nutrients that you're taking off the crop is going back to where it was. That's what always drove me up the wall. Now, they have cows which are in that wet, boggy hill bit. Now he makes his silage, he carts it up there, and he puts it through the cattle up there
onto the wet,
which will never be any better. Now, what he needs to do is keep where the silage or whatever is produced, it needs to go onto that land because that's where it's needed.
Well, you're probably going back to what they would say yesterday year in some ways. That was the way it worked. Was
that's
it
the way it worked, yeah. I mean, they didn't know what they were doing, but that's what they did, and it was the actual right thing to do.
They were like strip grazing kale.
Yes.
Dairy cattle and kale.
Yes.
You strip grazed it in the old days.
Yes.
Well, I mean, you maybe took a soak and go and did the job, but you went and did it. And you could tell where it was.
We strip grazing kale right next to the house, and we were halfway along it. But in the 80s, in calf cows ran with the milking cows, because they were in the buyer, and they just got a change thing off in the morning, and they went and ate their kale. Well, did you know calf? And we kept when we were up to Vinci's calf, but the calf had disappeared in the kale. It took 3 days to loop, hadn't it?
Your hands and knees. Is there any other, there are many other less toxic forms? I think in all phenol, we don't.
Well,
you need to help the grass to grow in some sort of.
Well, I mean, the only thing I can see is we need, like the New Zealanders, we need to put more. I know it's very difficult. We find it very difficult to get more clover into the sward because it's the actual keeping the weed population down is very difficult.
Regardless of what you do.
Up until my bat went, I spent my summers spot spraying off a quad bike. I spent my summers there, and that was the only way we could. He didn't get them all, but he got the majority
of them.
He got a good lot of them, and it kept the really pernicious weeds down.
Not so many folk want to do that now. I've done a wee while myself.
But when he first started, I did it year after year, and it did help. But I mean, the seed actual. A bank that's down there is unbelievable. Oh,
Jesus, Dawkins and nails.
You plow it up.
Adam was
Like
for years in the soil.
I always remember where they put the Grand Tapestry of Scotland. Well, that had been it must have been at least 150 years. What was in built where it was. Took it down. In 3 months, Dawkins came up. Now, where could they have been other than in the soil?
Underneath.
Huh?
Concrete or,
couldn't germinate?
It'll be very interesting over the next 5 years to see how the injection system of the slurries
is
going to take us forward.
Well, my son's been to a conference on trail and shoe. Now, the big problem with trail and shoe is that he put this strip down, and it doesn't go away very quickly, and that's where weeds come up.
In the strip. The ground has been broken.
Well, the thing is, he had been speaking to Nixon that he deals with the stuff with the AD planet Charlesfield.
He tears
the contract to haul all this digestate away.
Right.
And he does it with an umbilical spreader. And he says that's the only way that he's found that the umbilical pipe is being pulled across the thing and it spreads it out. You know,
it leaves a strip.
So he've either got to put it in the ground and find some way that he didn't let the weeds come up.
Through.
You know? All these things are the ideas getting them into practice.
Your income is at the mercy of lots of external factors. What do you do when disaster wipes out a product? Be it a crop ruined by weather, livestock tucked by disease or threat of disease, losing workers, prices suddenly plummeting. I think there's more than one question in there.
I think so. I mean, there's a lot of questions in there. Take the first thing, Jimmy.
External, you're at the mercy of external factors.
Well, you are.
But the external factors are humans quite a lot.
Well, they are, because that's That's the primary blend.
And you've got the policy makers and the...
Well, the policy makers, you're at the mercy because we're short of cash in the world in general to do things. Anything, it's like this latest spring thing with the 36 million we were supposed to get.
Right.
And they took it away. And we'll promise it back. We'll be lucky if we ever see it.
We've got 15 million back.
She's put 15 million back in just for some.
Well, she's.
You can get £100 to test your cows or something.
I know, it's not actually coming back. That's what annoys me. That if they can plunder a source of money, they will do it.
They'll do it. They're going to do it.
They're robbing Peter to pay Paul.
That's because the economies are in such poor state. I mean, we've had the health service for the same age as I am. Now, people have about to realise that we were getting more people in the country, so we were going to need more things from the NHS. But nobody did anything. So long as it was working in a sort of way, they were quite happy to leave it.
They're not looking 10 years down the road or five years down the road.
Has Britain not got to their population saturation point?
Well, it has. Really,
we can't cope with any more.
No.
That's not a vote catcher.
We were watching television this morning, and they were on about the blinking weather, you see. And it's always blinking. You never hear about any bad weather in Scotland. You always hear about it doing south. I says, aye, but there are nearly three times as many people in London than there are in Scotland.
But what do you do when disaster wipes out a product, be it your crop ruined by weather or livestock struck by disease or threat of disease?
At the present moment,
no, where the badgers, where the beavers,
no, beavers
bumped in the banks of the river and bust the river banks.
Yes.
I think that because
they had 90 acre of grain.
The big one, of course, was the foot and mouth thing, which wiped out.
I mean, they stood by, I have to say, they did then, but I don't think they'll ever do that again.
No,
we'll be ring vaccinating.
Unfortunately, I was one of the sufferers of the foot and mouth the last time. I sat for 8.5 months and never sold an animal.
Yeah.
And when I did sell them, I got a pittance for them.
Oh, that's the thing.
I reckon it cost me somewhere between £35,000 and £40,000 by the time I took the losses on the animals and the feeding I bought.
Aye.
And the annoying bit about it was the local village got a 60% grant for to do their shops up to the first level. Aye. And I got sweet nothing.
Yeah, that's it. It's very funny. The best thing was to get slaughtered out.
That was the best thing, to get slaughtered out.
Aye.
You only made money if you got slaughtered out.
Yeah.
Wouldn't have been nice. Well, we nearly got caught at the very end, right enough, but I don't think that sort of financial... You know, I always think, and the guys with animal guys would disagree with me completely, but I always think if your crop doesn't take, there's always a chance maybe you can resow it.
And get something.
But the... A sheep only lambs once in a year, and a cow only calves
once in a year. Yeah, if you have a disaster.
You're not lambing twice a year yet, are you?
No, not quite yet. But I have a son who'd like me to lamb twice a year, mate. Well, we kept pigs for many, many years, and that was one thing. If you had a disaster, the agent, you was got another lamb in six months' time.
But in the weather, you know, the weather, I don't care how well anybody's prepared, the weather rules the roost.
Yes. I mean,
a night's snow.
Yes.
We've all had it.
Well, I had lambs doing the bottom fields again at home. They were up against, they were behind the dike, like shelling, they'd be all right. Well, did they not go out and get into the wee wind that was next to you? And stuff coming down Dublin just killed.
Right, running off the trees.
Just come off the trees again.
Right.
Just falling down.
Losing workers,
well.
Even getting a worker.
Well,
workers is becoming a very serious problem in the industry.
Oh, they have that.
I think in a lot of industries, to be fair.
Well, I mean, there's brother, he's in Darien, and he had a go at robots. He couldn't get mine. And he got robots. Well, he didn't get on with them at all, so he took them and put a big parlour in. And he's always terrified that if that man leaves, where does he get? You know, the man that's working it. We've never we've always been family, so it's never it's never bothered us.
I know it's a
it's a very big problem.
Yeah.
I know if we're fucking Ireland who milking 250, 300 cows. They've been relying on foreigners to do the milking.
That's it.
But they come in at night and tell you, I'm going to Lincolnshire to cut vegetables, I can get more money.
That's it.
That's them away. And they just can't get folk to give them relief.
I think probably in our lifetime, you sort of followed on, just as we talked about at the beginning, you followed on to your father.
That's it.
Aye. There's a lot of that. But, you know, that's got, in fact, there's quite a lot of farmer sons and they don't even want it.
Well, they don't want that.
I shall be very surprised if our grandson, Blinken. He's 12 and he's not interested. He sees his life doing something else. I'm sure he does, you know. He never said to me. I mean, I thought he was taking interest here a wee while ago, but it's when it's mucky and wet, he's not interested.
I have a cousin in the Leicester Hager area. They're milking two farms, 250, 300 cows. The daughter-in-law has three sons. And there's only one taking a slight interest in agriculture, and that's through engineering.
But that's how it's going, you know. The single one-man band is going
forever.
Yeah.
I would have to say in our own thing, you know, like, this is no complaining, but, you know, there's not just a huge amount of money in there to, you know, pay somebody.
No.
In comparison what they can get
somewhere else.
For a week that starts on a Monday at dinner time and finishes it. Wednesday night.
That's
no easy getting for it. And we've a girl now, comes from a farming background, and a very, very good girl. And I'd have to say, probably over the nearly 24 years, the girls have all been better than the men.
Mm-hmm.
We've all been at lambing time and everything. The girls have all been
top
notch, to be fair. More conscientious than some of the men. It doesn't matter if you're going to speak to the haulage men or the joiners or the. It doesn't matter, but. And nobody wants to work at the weekends.
No, they don't.
You can forget.
But I mean, in that sense, if you've got to work in agriculture, you're better in a bigger business whereby you can get time off.
Prices suddenly plummeting, we'll think you've covered that in the food market. We've all had a wee touch of that.
We've all had touch it in careers.
And then on the pricing, would farming pay if there was no subsidies? Well, but quite, as far as we were concerned, they were fairly, I would have to say, probably.
Well, according to our accounts, without the subsidies, we wash your face, but that's about.
Well, yours will be fairly high, you know. I would say ours would it. I think we would need to do things differently. Oh. Really would.
Mm.
But as tenants, you're sort of, you know.
Yes,
the way the ground line.
He always says that what he does doesn't suit everybody.
No.
I mean, he does a lot of. I mean, he's got a fair bit of a business that's actually advisory. He's advisory.
So I believe, eh?
Mm-hmm. You know?
But so, I think that, you know, without subsidies.
Well, we'd have difficulty.
A great difficulty in making ends meet.
Yes.
I have been retired for 10 years now,
uh-huh.
And I have not one regret about stopping when I did.
Uh-huh.
The way things just went, the costs and whatever has been through the roof.
Yes, well, I'd
quite honestly, at the present moment, reading the farming press, I just wonder how many farmers is going to make it through to the other end.
Well, you just wonder.
But the subsidies, that you know, this subsidy word sometimes annoys me a wee bit, but. it's like the Scottish Government telling you that they've been very good and they've paid out the farmers so many million. Now, that payment, that type of payment's been there long before my
time.
You know, it was there to take your animals through the winter.
Yes, it wasn't
to put in a drawer and.
No, that's what it was.
And they seem to think this is new money. It's not new money. The bloody money's been there for years.
Yes, absolutely.
Who is getting the subsidy? Is the farmer getting the subsidy?
Yeah,
or is the consumer getting the subsidy because they need to pay a damn sight more for their food?
Well, that's the reason the food's just cheap.
That's the reason it's cheap because of a subsidy in the first place.
Yeah, well, I can also remember my father indignant because we were dairying.
We couldn't
get the uphills. Couldn't get it. You know? And we were working with the same land, but we still couldn't get it. Oh, it was absolutely indignant. Incandescent rage.
I mean, when the subsidies, some of the subsidies come in to start with, being in Lanarkshire, we grew a lot of seed potatoes at one time.
Aye.
Father was quite well up in the seed potato world.
Aye.
and we applied for a subsidy. For, I can't mind me what it was for, but we come back and told us, if you can grow seed tatties, you're not needing a subsidy on this land. And we didn't get it.
No, more or less similar to what we were feeling.
Dairy and seed tatties, yeah.
We
didn't get
it. Well, I think we were just more or less told, if you're dairy, you shouldn't need a subsidy. So that was it.
The final question, well, it was the final one, but this is how has Brexit affected farming?
It's been. It hasn't really affected us in some ways. Other ways it may well have done, but.
No, I didn't. I certainly didn't. I was not in favour of it.
No, I wasn't in favour of it either. But I think we, well, in sheep, we're lucky that the French still like a little lamb.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they take a hell of a lamb.
We complain about the stuff coming in, but we never complain about the stuff coming out.
Right. Well, you see, when we had pigs, we were about 45% finding sufficient pig meat, that's what we were. And then now, it's less than 35%.
Mm-hmm.
And they're moaning about what's coming in, the Dutch and the Danes, Netherlands in general.
Mm-hmm.
But we had a guy. He came. He's had one or two biting meetings, primarily with a college. And this guy, he's Danish, and the Danes, they're going to have to not cut their pig herd by half. They're going to have to cut it to 20% of what it was.
For what reason?
Because of the slurry.
Slurry emissions.
So they are now. The Danish pig industry, when it comes about, which it won't come about for a year or two, but it is going to be actually cut to, the Danes want to cut it by to 20%.
Mm-hmm.
So the pig meat that is coming to us from the Danes won't be there at all. So
it's hanging in there. The thing for Brexit, I think, and I always think there's pretty naive people think they would get rid of red tape. I could just never see that.
Well, I can never see it either, to be honest.
And Europe makes life quite difficult for us.
We tried to export, well, we did export three Leicesters to Switzerland 4 or 5 years ago now, and the red tape to get them away was absolutely horrendous.
Well,
the tests they had to go through.
In Aberdeenshire, these suffers.
Well, it was the very same procedures.
Oh.
It was about currently about 750 quid a head before we got them done.
But yet we don't seem to have any problem taking stuff in.
No, we'll take it in.
We'll take it in.
Look at the Heathrow situation.
Oh, aye.
57 ton of beef.
Beef coming in plastic bags in their luggage.
Right, in their luggage.
Can you imagine what the New Zealanders would do? They'd be absolutely hairy about that because they've gone absolutely spare about it. They won't have it.
We just seem to, well, as always said, you've got all these rules in different countries, but you come into Britain, they'll sort of multiply the same rule by 50 times over. Because it's keeping them all on the job.
Well, you see this African swine fever now. I bet it gets in here, the pig industry is done. Because of the fact that it'll just go through them like a bill of salt, so it's clean at the moment. But
my granddaughter's fiance, he's in that pig station down over the border.
Oh, aye.
And most of there are 200 boars in it. They're most of them created in Sweden, but they're not again. They've got some in quarantine just now, but after that, they don't know what's going to happen.
No, I know that it's.
And the dairy heifers, I believe, and it'll be the same Irishman that you were talking
about. Oh, it'll be the same Irishman.
There's no dairy heifers out of Holland for at least 2 years.
No.
I mean,
the circles that's closing in the UK a wee bit, whether that helps us...
I don't know.
I'm never too sure.
You have to just wait and see, don't you?
It's like back to the tree scenario.
Oh, aye.
And folks say, think all the sheep that would be on there. We're no struggling now to sell sheep. Sheep's been a good trade.
Yeah.
But imagine if all the sheep were still there.
We're just
Scotland and maybe... In particular, Britain, we're no great lamb eaters.
No.
I've got a son and a daughter. My son would never thank you for lamb, even though he works every day. My daughter and her family would probably eat it twice a week. Quite like it myself.
But
the big, you know, we're talking about populations. we've a lot to be thankful for the ethnic population.
Absolutely, they are taking a serious amount of stuff. I mean, they take that and they take on the bottom end.
And they're taking the top end, they're taking all ends, and all of these cows and everything that's
going on.
So,
well, a lot to be thankful for them. I mean, the government, they went to Berry Fell, and the right round about them was all being taken for trees, and the forest, the some big buyer came and offered them an unbelievable price for the, so they took it, and they bought a 400-acre arable farm down at Kelsey. That was how much the difference was.
Once this is switched off, I'll tell you who's got sheep in Berry Fell now.